in a couple of weeks, but I love the way that he made the top tips rather accessible. Just think about your hands ballroom dancing and sit up like a peacock. So
that
people thing, to take away.
The little race you did where you had a 200 metre
embarrassing
on a 300 metre
and I thought
race.
I stood a chance, but not a chance because of the speed. Far at
and
all.
He's a potential gold medal.
Well, he's the winner. Defending champion with Mark Hunter in the double sculls, yeah, so lots to go for, aiming to defend on his home water in front of his friends and family. Good luck, Zach.
Oh, Mike, we love you trying out those sports. Should we talk about the tour
the
now?
The tour, but I'm just fascinated to know.
Cyclists, but something has happened to British cycling. We've seen it on the track more. That's what we're familiar with. But now in the Tour de France.
Well, I mean, this is growing out of...
You know, he'll be there a week tomorrow, indeed. I mean, he even survived that flare, which was bizarre, wasn't it?
Particularly the Tour de France, because of history. I mean, the facts have shown that so many cyclists... We will know who comes out on top.
Is
it's a week tomorrow, isn't it?
Is your money on Bradley?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, your money would certainly have to be on Bradley.
Time now, 8:46. You're watching Breakfast from BBC News. A reminder of our main stories this morning.
Also, no, there are flood alerts again out this morning. Sarah can give us all the details. Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to you, Paul. Hello. What's going on then?
Well, the office affair...
At midday.
Indeed.
Doesn't matter if men don't wear wedding rings. The question has come up because David Cameron recently revealed he never would, even though the modern trend is for both partners in marriage to have them.
The Prime Minister isn't alone. Prince William didn't get one when he married last year, but every year many millions of men do. So how important are they? Here's what some of you think.
What's this all about then? I mean, are times changing? Are we treating marriage rings differently?
I think it tends to be down to individual choice. I mean, sort of just talking to friends before I came here, a lot of men say that they wouldn't wear one. And it does seem to be as well, if the father doesn't.
There is sort of historical change over whether men wear rings or not over the last, decades, years, hundreds of years?
Yes, in the last 52.
Jewellery designer, have you noticed as well more men wearing rings and perhaps more sort of elaborate rings as well?
Oh, without a doubt, yeah, the last 10 years.
Which thing was definitely something that a lot of people are like, oh my God, that's really bizarre to not wear a watch just because it's one of the few pieces of jewellery a man can wear. You know, you think the cufflinks, watch and a ring if they want to, so it does seem like a slightly odd choice not to wear a watch.
You obviously, I can see you both wearing watches. Charlie, you don't wear a watch either.
No, I don't wear a watch.
I empathise with that thing. I kind of don't like anything on my wrist. And if you're not used to... Thank you for those. Still to come on Breakfast this morning, we'll meet former international rugby player. And thank you.
At least 20 people have been killed and dozens wounded by a suicide attack on a wedding party in Afghanistan.
An 81-year-old woman and two men had to be rescued from their homes in Shropshire as heavy flooding affected parts of the county overnight.
Gordon Brown has been named as the United Nations Special Envoy for Global Education.
A £500 million scheme to electrify the Midland Main Line is expected to be announced by the government. Plans to...
On this right now, and I know that G4S have been doing interviews this morning. We are hoping to speak to them shortly on the programme. What are they saying about what's happened?
Yes, Louise, the chief...
The main thing that seems to come back is it all seems a little bit late, this, doesn't it? I mean, it's less than a fortnight to go.
Absolutely.
Answered right now, Louise. Thank you very much.
Yes, we can speak to Nick Buckles, of course, Chief Executive of G4S Security Now. It's compromised the security of the Olympic Games. Would that be true? Safe and secure games. It was your company that was given the contract, a very lucrative contract, to do that. I mean, are you apologising for the fiasco that's happened?
So this is complicated. You've got to... We had 110,000...
OK, so we're less than a fortnight to go right now. You are contracted to have 10,000 ready to go. How many do you have ready today? Can just be clear with me. So being scheduled, does that mean that they have all those security clearance and all the rest of it? They are ready and they're trained?
Yeah.
People emailing in the programme this morning who have direct experience of working with your company. Let me just tell you about one. My son was vetted and accepted for a security role. 10 days ago, he received his contract, which he duly signed and returned. He's heard nothing since. He's unable to get through to them for any information or answers. This person is not alone. We have had several emails like that. How come you're not answering phone calls? You're not telling people whether they are employed or not?
This is what a lot of people will be absolutely baffled by. Is that when presumably you were negotiating this contract and you were making your pitch for the work that you're a very proud, very established company, when you made your pitch, if you'd said at that point, with less than 2 weeks to go before the Olympics, you'd be scrabbling around asking students if they can come in for emergency courses, the government would have turned you away. It's a fiasco you've been in charge of at this late stage. To be talking the way you're talking about still trying to pull together the staff. A tough process, but it is less than 2 weeks. Those places that your security is supposed to be in charge of presumably already need securing. It doesn't happen on the day the games begin. It's an ongoing process. You know this better than me. And yet, you still don't have the staff with their badges trained up on the X-ray machines or any number of the other technologies which are absolutely essential to the safety of the games. Some people haven't even had that training yet.
No, everybody
will be working in those venues who are not yet trained. That's true, isn't
that's
it?
True.
By talking about what you had to say, if you like, to the British public who've invested so much in these games and now are looking at your organisation and thinking, how can we trust the security of the Olympics?
To those military personnel, some of whom have just returned from Afghanistan, who are missing holidays with their families, much needed and well-deserved holidays, what do you say to them?
Of those armed forces
and
personnel.
You heard him there in the last couple of seconds or so saying that he was sorry and embarrassed about what had happened. Listening to that was the Shadow Olympics Minister Tessa Jowell. Actually, we'll speak to her in a couple of moments' time.
First, though, let's take a moment, have a look at the weather. Sarah Keith Lucas is there for us.
Let's talk specifically about the sort of nailing it down, because he said there are 4,000 people ready in place. There are another 9,000 who have the training, he told us, have the vetting and all the rest of it. But it does seem, you know, watching this a little bit late, these 9,000 people aren't in place. Who is in control of all of this? It's a massive and, as he said, a very complex security operation. Do you think there are people in control? There is enough oversight of it all?
Well, I think that through...
Jill, thank you very much for your time this morning.
It is 28 minutes past nine. You're watching Breakfast from BBC News. Alex Bennett's career as a rugby union player has included time at a Premiership club and call-ups for his country. But last February, his involvement with the sport seemed at an end when he broke his neck while playing for his local team.
Yes, his doctors thought he might never walk again. But he amazed them with the speed of his recovery just 11 weeks after the accident. He was back on his feet. Now he's managed to get some of the biggest names in the sport together for a charity match to help others who've been injured.
And Alex joined. Yeah. Let's catch up on the sport. Mike's here again. Morning.
Yeah, good morning. Talking about being on show, there's been a lot of talk, hasn't there, about whether the home crowd at the London 2012 Olympics will be a positive factor for the GB athletes or whether it'll put them under too much pressure and they'll lose their nerve. Good news is last night the evidence was the former of those, that it was a real inspiration. Yeah, speeding up our athletes, giving them an extra yard of pace, I think. Good morning. Certainly the case for Perry Shakes Dre. Zach is now in Italy.
That
on
challenge,
his final
I love
warm-up
that.
Camp, training camp. And I believe that his fiance was watching that time. So good morning to soon to be Mrs. Purchase. Good luck. I know she'll be cheering him on.
Yes, because
at the finishing line on Dawny
Lane. He's right up there, isn't he?
Well, defending Olympics, putting no effort in, no sweat, and yet he still sped past me.
Very good, Mike. Thank you very much.
You're talking more about the Olympics now, aren't you?
In
a few minutes' time, talking about Usain Bolt.
9:47. You are watching Breakfast from BBC News. The main stories this morning. The chief.
Question for you this morning. Are you lost without your sat-nav? Have you ditched the old-fashioned maps in favour of directions from the small box on your windscreen?
Many people have. I haven't. Have you?
Nope.
Some figures suggest sales of printed road atlases and A to Zs have halved since 2005, and we're buying fewer ordnance survey maps as well.
So does new technology mean it's the end of the road for traditional paper maps? Nick Hyams.
Usain Bolt. He's expected to be one of the biggest stars of the Olympics. It's not just his athletic ability that has won him, though, millions of fans. There's something about his personality, both on and off the track, that keeps us watching.
One man who knows more about the sprinter than most of us, documentary. But those are the moments we know as outsiders, but you got a chance to film with him behind the scenes, you know, training and also with his mates, because that's a big part of who he is, isn't he? He's stayed very close to people he's known all his life.
Yeah, I mean,
we have a quick look at it before we move on. Let's have a look. The other thing that's really clear as well is he works. You know, this doesn't come like that, does it? He works incredibly hard and he's incredibly focused.
Because it's really tough, you know, it's really tough.
He's go now.
Yeah, less than two weeks.
Very exciting.
The Fastest Man Alive. It's on BBC One on Monday at 10:35. And viewers, that's in the evening in Wales, can see it at 11:05.
That's it from us from today. The programme will be on from 6 o'clock tomorrow morning. From us, though. Bye-bye.
Have a lovely weekend. Bye-bye.